Matthew chapter 12. Really interested in trying to walk you through verse 36 and 37, which is the climax of this whole unpardonable sin section that we've been dealing with. And Jesus is just a master at giving us insight and instruction. And I want to try to share that with you tonight. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified. By your words you will be condemned. Verse 36. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. The context is basically, as you know, Jesus has gone down to John the Baptist, been baptized, and the Father, through the Spirit, has filled a man called Jesus. So everything that's been happening in ministry and the flow of his whole life now is sourced by the Spirit of God. So you've got this phenomenal picture over here of what a man is when he's filled with the Spirit, what a person looks like when they're really filled with the Spirit. So when you're filled with the Spirit, you have the attitude of Jesus. The fullness of the Spirit is the works of Jesus. The fullness of the Spirit is the life of Jesus. The picture, the epitome of what it is to be sourced by the Spirit of God is to be like Jesus. So when we sing, "Oh, I want to be like Him," we're not talking about "I want to imitate Him." What we're really saying is, what filled Him, I want to fill me. What was in Him, I want to be in me. So that the same kind of thing through me that came through Him, the same kind of thing that came through Him will now come through me. That's what I want. And so I will be like Him in terms of sourcing and what produces my life. So it isn't just I'm going to try to duplicate His attitude. I'm going to get what He had, what was inside of Him, what was moving through Him, and I'm going to get that inside of me. Now, you know that He was the first one to have this. And that the new covenant has just been born. New covenant has just been born. And He's the first one to have this. And He's the prototype of what is to come. And through this sourcing of the Spirit of God and infilling of the person of God within Him, a man filled with God, he's going to end up dying. He's going to end up, which was the plan of the Spirit, he's going to end up dying. He's going to end up resurrected. He's going to end up ascending. He's going to end up reigning as King. And He's going to gather up the resource of the Father that the Father has given to Him. And He's going to pour it all over us. And we are going to be the second, the third, the fourth in the line. We're going to be a part of the new species that is being birthed out of this. That's you. And it all goes back to this sourcing, this fullness of the Spirit, this what is going on in Jesus that is making Jesus who He is. Now, in light of that, there's a whole other group on the other side. In this particular case, they are called Pharisees. And they also are religious. As Jesus is religious, they are religious. There's no problem with religion. Over on this side, they, of course, have taken the Scriptures. As Jesus believes in the Scriptures, they have also grabbed a hold of the Scriptures. It's Old Testament, Old Covenant. Jesus has just birthed a new covenant. They're in the Old Covenant. Now, in the Old Covenant, they've taken the Scriptures and they have developed a whole series of oral traditions, which was really a way of taking the Scriptures and adapting it to our own personal lifestyle of what we would like, a system that we would like to structure ourselves. So they set up a whole structure of their own making based upon the Scriptures, they said, and they formulated it for their own liking and adapted it and adjusted it and made it their own thing, and they call it their oral traditions. Jesus came along in the sourcing of the Spirit and said, "Oh, what you've got going on in your oral traditions is really self-sourced." A Spirit-sourced man walking into the self-sourcing of oral traditions does what? Well, exactly what Jesus did. He laughed it off. He pushed it aside. He didn't abide by it. In fact, he got into deep, deep trouble with the Pharisees because he was constantly resisting their oral traditions and what they had set up. which was all based on their own self-sourcing as they reached into the Scriptures. And instead of letting the Scriptures source them in the reality of truth, they took the Scriptures and utilized it, manipulated it, abused it, and used it for their own self-sourcing. And Jesus wouldn't tolerate it. So there ended up to be this overwhelming conflict between them. Now, in this conflict, it finally came to chapter 12. And in chapter 12, they're in the grain field. And, of course, the first scene in chapter 12 is the fact that they are saying, look, your disciples are picking grain on the Sabbath day. And said, "Woo!" Jesus said, "Woo! Good for them. They're hungry. Let them eat." Because he was more interested in hungry people being fed than he was in the oral traditions and the manipulation of their system. It escalated to the synagogue, which is the next scene in chapter 12. And in the synagogue, a man with a withered hand is now being healed by Jesus. And the Pharisees are all bent out of shape in accusation, saying, "What? That's a medical procedure on the Sabbath day. It could have waited till Monday. What are you doing?" And Jesus said, a man's withered hand, family, his whole life, because he never touches a person just physically. He always touches him in the wholeness of his life. And Jesus touched the man, made him whole, and a man in wholeness is much more valuable than your legalism, your law, your manipulation of the Scriptures to satisfy your own self-sourced ego. This took them to a conference room, which is the next scene in chapter 12, and self-sourcing is now plotting murder. And what is Jesus' spirit sourcing doing in the midst of self-sourcing plotting murder? Oh, that's easy. He's out with the multitude on the same day, and he's pouring his life out and healing all who were sick. Thousands, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miracles. Healing all who were sick. And then turning to them and saying, "Don't tell anybody about it." Now, when they got done in the conference room, of course, they came out and saw that all these miracles and people are rejoicing and the crowds are getting bigger and bigger. And Jesus does another miracle while they're there. And the miracle is he casts out a demon out of a man. Now, that wasn't too spectacular in light of what he had already been doing. So there'd been this whole series of miracles, and this wasn't really outstanding compared to all of those. Although it's fine, it's a great miracle, but it, in light of everything, but it was kind of a culmination of all of this, and the crowds are just going wild saying, "Whoa, this guy, this could be the Messiah. Do you suppose he is the one? Maybe he's the one we're looking for. Maybe this is the fulfillment of all we've dreamed about. Could it be? Could it be?" And the Pharisees are all bent out of shape, realizing they're losing control. So what do? They make accusation again. And it brings us to our scene. This fella does not cast out demons except by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons. And they're saying, "Oh, the way he does what he does, he is not sourced by the Spirit of God. That's not where all of this is coming from, as he claims." Yeah, I know, there was that time, Father through the Spirit filled a man called Jesus. But we watched him closely, and everything that's spilling out of him, all the miracles, all the great teachings, all the stuff, the thing that produces this man is the devil. And Jesus says, "Guys, what?" And he starts into this discourse. He starts with the sensibility, which is verse 25 down through verse 30. He logically walks them through that, but that was a total waste of time because they don't dwell on logic. If you logically sat down at a table and could think things through, your life would change. Come on, sit down at the table, reason it through. Here's sin, where does that get you? Here's cheating on your wife, where does that get you? Here's alcoholism, where does that get you? Here's drug addiction, where does that get you? Here's this, where does that get you? Over against, here's prayer, here's righteousness, here's the fullness of the Spirit, here's God sourcing you, where does that get you? Wow, logically you say, "I think I'll choose this." But see, we don't deal on that level. So if we could argue people into this, wow. But we can't. Why? Because it's not on the level of reasoning and logic. He comes to verse 31, which becomes the pivotal point of the entire passage. It's the the supposition. It is the pivotal point of all of it. He says, therefore I say to you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blaspheme of the Spirit will not be forgiven men. And he comes up with this overwhelming statement. Every single sin will be forgiven men, and every blasphemy will be forgiven men, but there's this one exception. And it's the blasphemy that comes out of your spirit. That will not be forgiven men. In fact, he says, let me give you the significance of it, and he gives an application. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him, either in this age or in the age to come. Jesus stands before these Pharisees and says, hey, look at me. Anything you want to say against me, I'll forgive you. Hey, slander me, I forgive you. Hey, throw stones at me, I forgive you. Hey, take me out to a cross and nail me, and I'll cry out, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Hey, I will forgive anything you want to do against me. But when you criticize, rebel against what's sourcing my life, there is no forgiveness of that, because forgiveness doesn't solve that problem. It's not a forgiving problem. It is a nature problem. In fact, he says, let me tell you a story. And he moves you to the next verse, verse 33, which is the tree thing. And he begins to talk about a good tree and bad fruit. See, you want to intermix them. You want to say, my tree is good, but my fruit is bad. That's an impossibility. You've got to put the good tree and the good fruit go together. The bad tree and the bad fruit go together, and you cannot intermix them. So obviously, if bad things are coming out of your life, what would be the conclusion? Your tree is bad. It's a nature problem. It isn't what's coming out of you. The fruit is only the evidence of what's inside of you. So do you see how ridiculous it is to say, yeah, out here, things aren't. Over here, wow, it is. I mean, this isn't, yeah, but I'm really basically a good person. He says, you can't put that together. That's the words of Jesus, people. And then he goes to verse 34 and says, let me talk to you. Let me reveal the speakers. Let's talk about you, the speakers. You're the ones who are calling this. You're the ones that are saying, I'm filled with the devil and sourced by the devil. And he calls them brood of vipers and says, you are evil, speaking good things. How are you being evil? Speak good things. He says, obviously, you can't. And he says, the reason I can call you out is because of the standard. And he says, the standard which judges this whole thing is the end of verse 34. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And we discussed that. The abundance is the idea of surplus. So he says, your heart produces all of this surplus. It's just all over your life. And you know what happens? Your mouth doesn't have to work at finding something to say, because there's this abundance that's all over the place. And what just out of your mouth comes out of what the surplus of what's going on in your life. So it isn't like, oh, what should I say? And I have to think it through and I have to search for something to say. It's that the heart is producing so much that it's just all over you, and it just... And he really goes after this idea of the mouth. Which brings us to verse 36 and 37. The supreme rule. Now he says, I know as I've walked through this with you, he's talking to the Pharisees now, keeping the context. I know as I've walked through this, what you've been doing is, I've been saying this, trying to get you to see reality and truth. And as I'm talking, you are figuring out what you're going to say back. That's the way we work, isn't it? See, in an argument with you, and you know what I'm doing? All the time you're saying, well, this and this and this and this. I'm thinking about what I'm going to say to you. I'm not listening to you. He says, that's what you guys are doing.
So you aren't listening to the great truth that I'm laying out for you. You're not thinking it through, saying, oh, I want to examine my life. I want to look at my life and see what's going on. I want to see the evil that's in my life. No, you're thinking, you're rationalizing, you're excusing, you're thinking up arguments. For instance, you're saying things like, now, wait a minute, good tree, bad fruit. Yeah, well, I do have some bad fruit. Yeah, there is a rotten apple on that limb. But, hey, the weather's been bad. And there are worms, you know. And there are bugs. And it isn't my fault, and not all my fruit is bad. And you're thinking up rationalizations, and you're thinking of excuses, and you're thinking of, come on, you gotta. And you're trying to adjust. He says, here's what I want to do. Instead of arguing with you and walking you through where you are, I want to take you where you're going to be. And you know where you're going to be one day? You're going to be slap dab at the final hour, where it's all going to be wrapped up and there is no tomorrow. And you're going to stand in the final hour of judgment. And you aren't going to be able to say, well, yeah, what you say is right, but the Lord isn't done with me yet. Well, no, he is done with you, because this is the drawing of the line. No, there's growth afterwards, I understand that. But in the calculation of this is the final moment. There is no more, well, yeah, I'll work on that. No, you can't work on that now, because the line is drawn. And the final judgment, and we're down to the bottom line and the conclusion of everything. And everything is coming together. And there will be no more argument. There'll be no more adjustment. It's all come down to the final conclusion itself. Let's think, he says, in that context. How would what I'm telling you work out in that context? And he starts with the word but, which is conjunction, which is contrasting conjunction. I just want to walk you through this. In other words, I am going to contrast this over here, which is fruit bearing, a tree bearing fruit and growing in its season and got time to work on it and the operation of your life and how many more years do you have? Well, who really knows? And there it all is. You're in that context. Now I want to take you, but I want to take you over here now where there's no time left. We're down to it. We're nose to nose with the thing. The final line is drawn. Hey, it's all wrapped up and the eternal destiny of our lives is now settled. Where are you then? That's the contrast. The next statement he says is, I say to you. Which, by the way, I is the main subject of the sentence. Say is the main verb, which is an emphasis, obviously, upon the person of Jesus. And every time he says this, it is an authoritative, I know what I'm talking about, we're down to it kind of a statement. This is, hey, you can't argue with this. This is the authoritative view of the Spirit of God that is sourcing the person of Christ. And note he's saying it to you, which by the way is in the dative, which you don't give a rip about, but that's an indirect object. In other words, what I'm going to say is directed to you. Now, what is it that he's going to say? That. And this becomes the direct object. In other words, all of the say is going to be that. Whatever comes out of this, whatever's after this, that's what he's really trying to say to them. This is all directed directly to them. Who are they? Pharisees. Who are they? Self-sourced individual who are using religion for their own ends. What I've got to say is in the contrast of Not you've got time to work on it. Not present tense. Not, well, this is 2014. There'll be 2015, then 2000. Make plans. No, we're out of that. We're down to the drawn line. Judgment is here. A whole thing is wrapped up. Psst, hey, I'm talking in the eternal state. You've got no more chance. here's what I've got to say to you. It's really strong. He then comes to men, which includes you women. It's really human beings. And he says in verse 36, I say to you that for every word men, human beings. So we're talking about, obviously, you. We're not talking about your pet. We're talking about you. He is talking about you. He is talking about me. And it's the subject of this clause. And then he comes up with may speak. Interesting word. See if you can get a hold of this. It's the Greek word lelo. Another Greek word lego, which is content. This is not about content. In other words, he says, I'm not going to talk about what you say, because I'm not interested in talking about that. You said that word. I heard you. You told that joke. I heard that. No, we're not dealing with that. Hey, get off of that. Which is the opposite of what I thought of where I thought this was going. Because when you read it, it says every idle word. Whoops. Have you ever said an idle word? Yeah, well, we're not talking about that. Because if you take all the idle words out of my sermon, I probably wouldn't have one. Because we say a lot of dumb, meaningless stuff, don't we? We joke around, don't we? I say, how you doing? And I don't give a rip, don't we? Don't we? Yeah, we do. So if you took all the idle words out of our conversation, and if I was going to be judged for every stupid idle word I've used, good night. Just burn me now, boy. But he's not dealing with that. The lalo is not upon content, it's upon the act of speaking. And he's saying, you know what your life is? Your life is one big mouth. Now, some of us like me can really, really identify with that. Because it's a match set, nose and mouth. But, again, idle words. See? We're full of it, aren't we? But he's not dealing with your idle words in that sense. He's not dealing with, hey, I don't want you to ever say the D word. I don't want you to ever say words that are meaningless. I don't want you ever, every time you speak, it's got to have big... No, he's not saying that. You never can tell a joke. Come on, get away from that. You never can jest. No, don't, no, no, we're not talking about that. I'm not even dealing with content here. What I'm dealing with, he says, is the fact that your life is... Think about this, the concept of it. Your life is one big mouth. In other words, your life is constantly, totally, absolutely, all the time speaking, and it's speaking loudly. One of the first pastorates we had, the Sunday school superintendent, he announced up front to me, came to me, announced up front. He said, listen, I'm Sunday school superintendent. I'll be faithful, I'll be there, run the Sunday school. But every time there's a fifth Sunday, that's my Sunday off. And I'm gone. That's an interesting concept, isn't it? You know, I'm religious, 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 religious. Fifth Sunday, I'm gone. Well, you need a break from religion, you know? You really do. So, hey, I'm one big mouth, except on the fifth Sunday. No, you're a big mouth on the fifth Sunday too. In other words, there is no vacation from this speaking, which is very significant. You got the concept? Okay, then he goes to every, the word every, which is the Greek word, and this is interesting because, again, this verifies what I'm trying to tell you. This is the Greek word for all. So it isn't every like in each. It isn't like, oh, every idle word meaning that one there and that one there and that. It isn't a particular. It's just the category of all, folks. So all you speak, not just, it's all you speak. So he's taken the whole speaking. Your life is one big mouth, and all that comes out of it, which is this. And this is really interesting. Word. Now, immediately I thought, oh, I know what this is going to be. Logos. John 1. In the beginning was the Word. Jesus is called this. So he's tying himself into this. No, he's not. It's not the Greek word. It's rhema. Well, that's different. Yeah. What's that all about? Well, let me try to give you a handle on that. Logos, which Jesus is called, the Word, is a rational, reasonable, intellectual, rational thought, basically. 2 + 2 = 4. That's a reasonable, rational, factual thought. Logos. Rhema is the topic of discussion, the overall. Be lots of ways I suppose to say this, but out of the mouth of God comes a topic. What is God discussing? And the rational, reasonable thought process of that is Jesus. When you're watching Jesus, you're seeing the overall arching theme of what God wants to talk about, and the day in and day out life of Jesus is the rational, reasonable thought of that topic. So he says, the issue that I want to talk to you about here is your life is one big mouth. And I'm going to bring you to the day of judgment. And you know what we're going to examine? Oh, you told that joke. No, you said that. No, you used that. No. You know what we're going to talk about? With the day of judgment, we're going to talk about what was the overall topic of your mouth's discussion. If your life is one big mouth, what is it your mouth, the topic that your mouth always presented? And he throws in this word idle, which is the Greek word which comes from two words. A, which is this obviously, which means without. And ergos, argos or whatever it is, which means work. So it's without, without work. So idle is worthless. It doesn't accomplish anything. It's just, it's like if you hired me to wash dishes. It would be worthless. That was a bad example. Because I'm worthless at doing that. I was thinking of all the dishes you're going to help us do after the service is what I was thinking. Trying to prepare you. So now go back to the passage. So what he's saying is, every idle word, all the words, your one big mouth, And all the words that come out of you, are they worthless? The topic, we're talking about the topic. The topic that your life consistently addressed with its mouth, was it worthless? Into my life. And I say, well, I was a movie star. Worthless. Well, hey, I was a good person. Worthless. Well, hey, I was honest and I worked hard. Worthless. Worthless. See, what is the topic of your life that you're going to be able to come up at the final hour and say, whoa. Well, that's what they're talking about. See, over here is a spirit-sourced life. Jesus literally sourced by the Spirit of God. Over here are the Pharisees that are self-sourced. What a fruit is to a tree, your mouth is to your heart. And on the final hour, the only topic that's going to be worth anything is, oh, Jesus possessed me and sourced everything that came out of me. Therefore, every word, even a joke, every word, even a casual statement, every word, even just a friendship thing, every word, even how are you doing, every word that came out of my mouth was valuable because he was the source of my living. So Jesus, if I get this tonight, if I understand this, it's not that you want me to correct my words and say fewer jokes and not have any jest and not say worthless things. It isn't that. It's that you literally want to, the topic of my life, that you're not an add-on, you're not just a part of, you're not one aspect of, you are literally to be the core of my heart. And Lord, I weep tonight over the evangelical church, and I weep over what's going on in our religious world, and I'm broken in my heart. Because God, we run so many good programs. We do the Sunday morning thing, we have developed a really neat group of Pharisees. Do something in me that won't allow that to happen. Do something in the core of my being that, Lord, if I'm one big mouth, my life is one big mouth. Could the topic that is being produced moment by moment, second by second in my life be produced by you? And could the only worthwhile thing in my whole life be what you're doing? Could I be a vessel through which you work? Could I be the instrument of your divine action? Could I be the thought, the reasonable explanation, rational, intellectual presentation of your mind and your heart and who you are? Could my life speak
you to my world. Heads are bowed. Come to the final hour. Line is drawn.